Hello everyone and welcome to the Pencil Tutors channel. I'm Serfina and today I will be teaching the topic of linear motion and free fall motion. This is Form 4 Physics Chapter 2, Subtopic 2.1 and 2.3. So without further ado, let's get started. First off, what is linear motion? Linear motion can be defined as a motion in a straight line. So actually, when you look at a graph that has a straight line shape just like this, it would be described as increasing linearly. So, the concept of linear motion actually applies to any sort of object that is moving in a straight line, whether it be a car moving or a human running. The concept of linear motion would apply to all of these objects just as long as they're moving in a straight line. Now, before I get into the terms that we have to learn in linear motion, I would like to briefly recap on some of the things that we have learned in Chapter 1, specifically scalar quantity and vector quantity. Scalar quantity is a physical quantity with magnitude only, while vector quantity is a physical quantity with magnitude and direction. Now, what does this actually mean? So, in vector quantity, the direction of motion of the object, whether it be to the right or to the left, would play a part and actually affects the final quantity. And in scalar quantity, the direction of motion of the object is actually not accounted for and is not important. There are about 5 new terms in linear motion that you have to be familiar with. First off, we have distance and displacement. Distance is the length of root cover. Displacement is defined as the shortest distance between the initial position and the final position of an object in a specific direction. First off, I would like to point out the biggest difference between distance and displacement is the fact that distance is a scalar quantity, while displacement is a vector quantity. Therefore, in distance, the direction of the object is not important. However, when you're looking for displacement, the direction of the object plays a part and actually affects the final quantity. I know some of you are still confused on the difference between these two, so to make it very clear, I'm going to give you a very simple example. Let's say we have 3 points. We have point A, point B, and point C, and these are the distances between those 3 points. Let's say we are a human person at point B, and we are traveling to A, and then we are traveling all the way to C. So, if the question is asking for the distance, it would be simple. You just have to sum up the distance that we travel, which is 20 plus 20 and plus 50. And the distance would be 90 meters. However, when we are looking for the displacement, it is a bit different. First off, when you are looking for a vector quantity, you have to set the specific direction that you are looking for. Usually, by default, in this sort of questions, any sort of motion that is towards the right will be of a positive value, and any sort of motion that is towards the left will be of a negative value. So, as we can see, first off, we move towards the left to A, so that would be negative 20. And then towards the right, so that would be positive 20. And then towards the right again to C, so that would be plus 50. So in total, the displacement would actually be only 50 meters. And this would actually align with the definition of displacement, which is the shortest distance between the initial and final position of the object in a specific direction. Next, we have speed and velocity. Speed is defined as the rate of change of distance, and the formula of speed would be speed is equal to distance over time, with d being distance and t being the time taken. Velocity is similar to speed because velocity is the rate of change of displacement. So the formula of velocity would be v is equal to s over t, with s being displacement and v being velocity. Now, just like distance and displacement, the biggest difference between these two is that speed is a scalar quantity and velocity is a vector quantity. The SI unit for these two quantities is meter per second. Lastly, we have acceleration. So, acceleration is the rate of change of velocity. And the formula for acceleration is A is equals to V minus U divided by T, with A being acceleration, V being final velocity, and U being initial velocity. Now, if you notice, when you look at the formula, we have a final velocity and an initial velocity. So, what this actually means is that in order for there to be acceleration, the initial velocity and the final velocity of the object must be different, and the velocity needs to change. Therefore, when the question says that it has a uniform velocity, this means that the velocity is constant. Therefore, there would be no acceleration. But if the question says that it has non-uniform velocity, this means that the velocity is changed. And when the velocity is changed, there would be an acceleration. The SI unit for acceleration is meter per second squared. Now, when we answer a linear motion questions, there's actually a lot of way for the question to be manipulated. For example, the question could give you no displacement, or no time, or no velocity, so it will be quite difficult for you to satisfy whatever the question wants. Luckily, we can derive four different equations that could help you to answer whatever the questions want. First off, we have V is equal to U plus AT. And you would use this equation when you do not have the displacement. Next, we have S is equal to 1 over 2 U plus V times by T. And you would use this equation when you do not have the acceleration. Very sorry for my writing here, by the way. And third, we have S is equal to UT plus 1 over 2 AT squared. And you would use this formula when you do not have the final velocity. And lastly, we have V squared is equal to U squared plus 2AS. And you would use this when you do not have the time taken. Now, there's actually a step-by-step way on how to actually get these equations. However, the question in examination would never ask on how to derive. So, personally for me, just memorize these equations and you'll be good to go. So, in order for you to further understand how to actually apply those equations in a question, we're going to answer a question together today. So, the question says, a car moves from rest with an acceleration of 2.0 meter per second square. Calculate velocity of car after 5 seconds, distance traveled in 5 seconds, and distance traveled in the 5th second. So first off, when I answer a question, what I would do is I would list out all of the information that we have. The question says that the car is moving from rest. What this means is that the initial velocity of the car is equal to 0 because it is not moving at first. Acceleration is at 2.0 meter per square. And from the first question, we know that the time is 5 seconds. So what I would do is I would just use the first equation and just substitute all of the value that we have. And we would get the velocity after 5 seconds is 10.0 meter per second. Next, the question is asking for the distance travel in 5 seconds. So, I would actually use the third formula for this one. And I would just substitute all of the information that we have. And we would get the distance travel in 5 seconds is 25 meters. So next, I'm going to talk about free fall motion. Now, what exactly is free fall motion? So free fall motion can be defined as the motion of an object that is affected only by gravitational force. So in normal daily circumstance, the motion of an object would usually be affected by something we call air resistance. So in free fall motion, there would actually be no such thing as air resistance, and this situation would only occur in something we call vacuum, or if the question says to ignore air resistance. So if you see these two terms, it means that the question is talking about the concept of free fall motion as opposed to a linear motion. There's actually a few examples that are talking about free fall motion. For example, if the question is talking about throwing an object upwards or about an object falling down, in these two situations, they're actually talking about free fall motion. Now, because in free fall motion, the motion of the object is only affected by gravitational force, the acceleration of the object is actually constant because it is affected only by the gravitational acceleration. And so the value of that is 9.81 meter per second square. And actually, you could use the linear motion equations that we have learned just now, but you can just replace the A with G and insert the value of gravitational acceleration, which is 9.81. So in order for you to understand the concept of free fall motion, we're actually going to do a question together. So the diagram shows a 1.2 meter height girl throwing a ball vertically upwards. So we know this is talking about free fall motion at velocity of 20 meter per second. So determine the total distance taken by the ball until it reaches the ground. So first off, what you need to know when you answer a question just like this, when you throw an object, it will reach a certain maximum height before it goes back down towards the ground. Now, when the object is at its maximum height, the velocity of the object would actually be zero, just like what I've written here. Now, I have already written out I've already drawn the trajectory pathway of the ball, and I've separated it into three portions, number one, number two, and number three. Now, we already know the distance for number three, which is the same as the height of the girl, but we don't know the distance for number one and number two, so we're going to go ahead and use the equations that we have learned just now and find the distance. So I'm going to go ahead and use the fourth equation because we do not have the time. Now, since we are looking for the distance at the first portion only, and as you can see here, at the first portion, when it's at its final velocity, the final velocity is equal to zero. So the initial velocity would actually be this one. So the value that is given here is actually the initial velocity for the first portion of the distance that the ball traveled. So I'm just going to substitute that into the question. And the A is the value of gravitational acceleration, which is 9.81. However, because the question is talking about a ball moving vertically upwards, and as you guys know, gravitational force is towards the ground, so it is downwards. Gravitational acceleration, the direction is downwards, and because the ball is going upwards and it is in the opposing direction, so the value would actually be negative 9.81. So when we solve the equation, we would actually get the distance traveled is 20 meter. So now from the diagram that I've drawn here, we know that the distance for the first and second portion is actually the same. So it is both 20 meter. So now in order for us to calculate the total distance taken, all we have to do is just calculate all of it. So the total distance would be 20 meters plus 20 meters plus 1.2 meter. So that would give us 41.2 meter, which is the answer to this question. Alright guys, so that is all for today's lesson. Next week, I will be covering linear motion graphs and also inertia. So stay tuned for that. Make sure to like this video and subscribe to our channel. Don't forget, we post videos every Monday, Wednesday and Friday covering the subjects of physics, mathematics and biology. That is all from me, Sarvina. Thank you so much and I'll see you guys around.